We're now joined by Georgina Godwin, who was born and brought up in Zimbabwe and also a journalist there too. It was part of your journalism that got them to want you to leave, wasn't it, in a way?
Absolutely. I mean, for me, it's quite odd being here because I used to present breakfast television in Zimbabwe and also radio. And we started an independent radio station there, a group of us, which was shut down, obviously, very quickly and quite violently. And I came here for what I thought was 6 months, you know, left my book open on the bedside table, that sort of thing. And that was 16 years ago.
Wow.
We've been, all of us, declared enemies of the state. So obviously no friends of Mugabe. What's wonderful for us to see is the way that the media is changing from just the music that's been played on the ZBC.
Zimbabwean media.
Revolutionary songs that weren't allowed under Grace Mugabe, and the way that all of the papers now, and the people, of course, themselves, are attacking him. I think, although he may not want to go, he's got absolutely no support from the people any longer. There's no way he can stay.
What about the fact that there's a question that his departure doesn't necessarily mean real change, because his regime is so embedded? I think there was a quote to say there's 5,000 people who've all been feeding at the same trough. You'd have to get rid of all of those to see real change.
Oh, I mean, that's indisputable. I mean, I think that any of the new leaders are the old guard. They certainly have blood on their hands. But what this is an opportunity to do is to open up more of a national dialogue. In fact, they do now have something called the National Democratic Project, which is everybody coming together. And what we hope it will lead to through a transitional government is free and fair elections. I think what's happening at the moment is that Zimbabwe is under international scrutiny, very intense international scrutiny. And so it's going to be very hard for Mnangagwa or anybody, perhaps Sidney Sekeremai, the defence minister, who takes over, to get away with anything. Having the media there and people like your correspondent is fantastic for Zimbabweans, and I think that all those journalists there should be reassured that they are absolutely safe. Zimbabwe needs this coverage, and as long as you're looking at us, we're okay.
Is the worry, though, as Kate said, because there's so much corruption surrounding this government, the ZANU-PF and Mugabe himself, that the threat won't come from the Zimbabwean people, who are desperate to get the story out and to keep things, or to maybe get back to some sort of democracy, but from the regime that is trying to control things and declared you an enemy of the state?
Mugabe has no support. The police have stepped down. There's not a policeman to be seen in Harare. All sorts of rumours about what's happened to the chief of police. There will be no fight back from anybody that supports Mugabe himself. So I think in terms of any kind of civil war, that's unlikely to happen. The problem comes if Mugabe doesn't step down, because then they're in contravention of the African Union's constitution, and that then really does make it a coup. And then perhaps you're looking at some kind of regional fight back, only because of various mutual defence pacts. Nobody wants Mugabe to stay, except Zambia, oddly.
Why Zambia?
Who knows? But all of the SADC countries want him to go. Zambia's the only one saying, they're all saying it must be done constitutionally. Zambia's going, yeah, shouldn't happen at all.
Really? So they're sort of entwined somehow. I'm sure you've got friends and maybe some family still out in Zimbabwe. How are they feeling about this?
I think people are quietly optimistic. I mean, the thing is, we've been to the brink so many times before. My brother is an author and wrote a book called The Fear, The Last Days of Robert Mugabe, about 5 years ago, so somewhat prematurely. You know, this keeps happening to us. And today there are wobbles that, he's brought us to the brink once again. But I think there is no option. He will have to go. I imagine it will happen later today. But if not, certainly very, very shortly.
And do you envisage a time, Georgina, when you'll be able to go back?
You know, the problem with being in exile is that although you may look and talk like the country where you've gone, and I acknowledge that compared to most people in exile, I'm fantastically privileged, you have to assimilate or be very, very unhappy. And I'm here now. My life is here. I have a child at school here. I have a dog, a 93-year-old mother who can't be moved, and a career in the British media. It's not going to be easy to relocate, and I think that perhaps it's up to the younger generation to go back and rebuild Zimbabwe, but certainly I really hope that people do, and we'll be cheering them on from the sidelines.
What do you think will happen to Mugabe himself? Will he have a safe final years somewhere, or will there be repercussions for him?
Well, I think this is exactly the discussion that's going on at the moment. So I imagine that it will be health-driven. He'll go somewhere where he can get the medical care that he needs. He's got houses in Singapore, we think in Hong Kong, and also in Dubai. He can't go to South Africa because his wife keeps attacking people there. There was that little diplomatic incident. He will go to one of those places, and I imagine right now what they're doing is ironing that out. There'll be some kind of financial payoff. He'll be allowed to keep some of the money, and he'll be allowed to go with dignity. Don't forget that Zimbabwe, and indeed most of Africa, feel that they owe him, as a great liberator, as indeed he was, some kind of debt. So he's not going to be strung up from a lamppost. He's going to be allowed to step down with his head held high, and that's why they're allowing him to take his time, I think.